Good evening and welcome. My name is Alex Krigelis, Dean of Visual Arts and Media Studies, and on behalf of our college president, Dr. Rocha, who is seated here on the first row, and the Board of Trustees, I would like to welcome all of you to this special evening. This has two parts. The first one is the lecture and presentation by our artists in residence of this year, and the second one will be the public opening in our art gallery, which will be around 8:30. So if you were to step outside of the auditorium and take a sharp left, walk through the campus in the main quad of our campus, there is a small building that is the art gallery. Most people will be moving at that time in that direction. Just follow us and you will have no difficulty finding it. Our artist in residence of this year is a multifaceted individual who works across many disciplines and challenges traditional preconceptions about art and art making. Parenthetically, last Friday, I sat in the gallery with a number of other students from Art 75 who were to work with our artists to set up the exhibition, help with the installation, and I was present in the exchange. This is what makes my job and everybody else's job a great one, that we can take a moment and we can observe somebody at the high end of his craft and his capacity to communicate great ideas, which without we couldn't really do anything. So I followed the students for about 45 minutes, and then I got up and I had to walk away because many people were coming into the gallery, and I didn't want to take any more space. But I thought I was really inspired. And I was so inspired that I thought this weekend, which was just around the corner, was going to be my weekend in the studio. And I want to thank our artists for pointing into the direction, the right direction. This Friday, I would like you to keep in mind at 1 o'clock, there will be a reception, a closing reception in the art gallery. And at that time, all of us will make some brief remarks, and the artist will gift the college with an original piece, which becomes part of the permanent collection. This was something that we did not intend when we started the program, but sure enough, 25 years later, the college has a collection of contemporary work that is quite remarkable, and you can see it if you were to walk through the levels of the library of the college. Probably most of you do not know that this program was established 25 years ago, and it was the idea of Suzanne Bravander, emeritus professor from our division, the Visual Arts and Media Studies. Over the past 25 years, many people have come through the program. I will just mention some of the names. Nathan Oliveira, Jose Luis Cuevas, Patty Graham, Andres Nagel from Spain, Alexis Smith, William Wegman, Mary Frank, Wayne Thibault, Misami Terioka, a number of incredibly influential artists that have contributed to the conversation. And we're very fortunate to have all of them. Last year, we had Gary Panter, who was a change of pace and added to the mix in his own individual way. In order for an idea to grow and to be sustained, you need to be able to make your case to the community. And over the years, a number of institutions and individuals have helped us build the program and keep it in place. Without them, you can launch it for a year, maybe two, but after that, you're going to be in some difficulty keeping it going. So I want to thank the organizations and the people that have made it possible over the years, the Jameson Foundation, the Pasadena Arts Alliance, Art Alliance, Typecraft Incorporated, PCC Foundation, the College Administration, the Digital Media Center, and a number of generous individuals who have followed our division and our college for many years and wish to see it continue to do the things we have done all along as well as we can. Clearly, beyond the financial support, you couldn't have this without the support of our faculty. And I would like to recognize the people that they are in the audience today, that they were instrumental in making the program over the long term possible, but also this particular residency. Jim Morfisis, who is the advisor of this program for this year, Brian Tucker, the gallery director, and his crew that manages somehow to operate the gallery from so to so flawlessly, Lindsay Jane of the film department, Rico Saka, design department, Warren Swill, journalism, Dina Caparelli, studio, and Victor Diahara, who is our graphic designer and has been working with us for a long time. I will be remiss if I will not mention our two secretaries that manage the nuts and bolts and day-to-day business, Judy Holmes and Nitrong. And of course, there are a number of people around the college outside of the division that makes this possible. I will mention again our president, Mark Rocha, Rick Van Pelt, college facilities, Juan Gutierrez, public relations, Shireen Adley, who is back in the booth doing the videotaping right now, Richelle Allen, the photographer, Pat Reese, web producer, Tai Yu, who does the food for all of the receptions, Johari DeWitt Rogers of the media services, and T. Barrett and Steve Diedrich of staging services. You can see by the naming of all of these individuals that it takes a whole village to make this happen every year. Our Artist in Residence program emphasizes the value of considering and study the artist and his and her work. It encourages thoughtful exchange of ideas and interaction among students and practicing artists who deeply care about the same things. It is designed to celebrate the arts and to motivate and inspire. Our invited artists have an opportunity to show their artwork, talk about their ideas, impart experiences, demonstrate the creative and technical working processes, and discuss what turns them on and why they create. Students and faculty, for a brief period of time, also have the opportunity to slow down, to become participants, observers, and listeners, raise questions for the artists as well as for themselves about issues surrounding the arts and the art-making process. During the week-long residency, all division programs as well as college life are enhanced by the multitude of interactions. Concurrently, an art exhibition of the artist's work will be on view in the art gallery and will enhance, and most likely will enhance the likelihood of everyone coming through because they may have the chance to meet the artist himself. The residency has been designed to engage us all visually, intellectually, and emotionally, a festival of creativity intended to provide a forum and opportunities for everyone in our communities. Over the past 25 years, the Artist in Residence program has brought 25 significant visual artists from a number of continents and from around the United States of America, representing almost every part of the art spectrum. With this year's choice, we feel that we have broadened the menu and introduced an artist to our community who says that he recognizes the energy of the issues of our times that we live in. As I have mentioned many times, 25 years ago, the college administration, the PCC Foundation, art organizations, and generous individuals from the community came together to create a consortium that established the financial base for such an extraordinary program. 25 years later, the same partners are still with us and at work, verifying the results and endorsing the new path the program is taking. This is a remarkable achievement, confirming the importance of art in our lives and the value of collaborative work and community-building relationships. For all of us here at Pasadena City College, maintaining excellence in our programs is both a priority and an issue of equity. Nothing gives us greater satisfaction than the realization that our students receive the best experiences as do students of renowned institutions. Nothing gives me greater satisfaction than the knowledge that as public institution of higher education, we function at the level we were designed to. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Jim Morfisis, a colleague and a professor of art, division coordinator, and this year's advisor to the Artists in Residence Committee, who is going to introduce to you our Artists in Residence of this year. Jim came to the Visual Arts and Media Studies Division in the fall of 1997. He received his BFA in painting from Tyler School of Art in Temple University in Philadelphia, and he holds an MFA in art from California Institute of the Arts. He has taught in a number of 4- and 2-year institutions, including Claremont Graduate University, Art Institute of Southern California, Otis College of Art and Design, Los Angeles City College, California Institute of the Arts, Immaculate Heart College, and Cal State Northridge. It is my pleasure to introduce to you one of our principal professors in painting and drawing, whose professional practice, which includes exhibiting and lecturing about his work and research nationally, regionally, and internationally, has helped elevate the profile of our programs and attract students who want to study under his tutelage. Jim is a close associate and a good friend of Daniel Martinez, this year's Artist in Residence. Jim?
This is good. I've got Daniel's sandwich up here. All right, that's what I need, a little pressure. I'm not good reading this stuff, but there's so much that I have to go over and talking about Daniel Martinez that I'm going to be reading from this for a while, so forgive me for that. But let me just get started, because I want to be brief. We're here to see and listen to Daniel. Daniel Joseph Martinez is a proud Los Angeles native, born in East Los Angeles, and now an internationally recognized artist by the art world, and most importantly, respected by every serious artist who deserves any consideration. Yeah. We can all agree with that. Daniel has been exhibiting internationally for more than 30 years and transcending, transcending categories of style all the way. His work has been the subject of museum exhibitions and numerous one-person gallery exhibitions. Fairly recently, Daniel officially represented the United States in the Cairo Biennial, 2006. Great piece. Great piece in that. Well, there's a lot to see. Wherever Daniel goes, here's the proof. Wherever Daniel goes, there's a situation. He has participated in the San Juan Triennial, 2004, the Lima Biennial, this is recently, 2005, and the 2007 Moscow Biennial. I think these towns make up these shows so that Daniel will come and show there. In the United States, Daniel's work was part of the 2008 Whitney Biennial, the seminal, and for some time, I think you can still say, the seminal American exhibition of what's happening in the art scene. And he was in the California Biennial at the Orange County Museum of Art in 2008, the Houston Photo Fest Biennial, this is actually starting to be fun, Photo Fest Biennial 2010, the Quebec Biennial. See, if you do well as an artist, you can travel. Yeah, this is a good reason to travel. The Artists Museum exhibition at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles, which recently came down. That was 2010. Daniel has received 3 National Endowment of the Arts Fellowships, a Getty Fellowship, a Pollock Krasner Fellowship, and the 2010 Fellows of Contemporary Art Fellowship, among other awards. You see, we told you, we're bringing a famous person here.
That's pressure.
Well, it's too late now. But the question is, how the heck does Daniel produce all of this work and come up with all of these ideas? You'll experience this, I think, but I've often said about Daniel, he moves faster sitting still than most of us do at a full gallop. It's an incredible amount of energy to do all of this work. Saying a little bit about Daniel's work, which I always find difficult to talk about. There's so many levels to it. In his work, Daniel uses a complex vocabulary, which includes text, sculpture, installation, painting, video and photography, and perhaps, I would add architecture and science fiction. Heavy on the science fiction, yeah, I think so. And now I know so. He turns time inside out as he deals with history, geopolitics, social and political mores. For me, more than anything else, though, I think it's really deeply personal work, as large as it seems. For me, it also gets right to it for every individual. What I don't like about Daniel Martinez's work. Whenever I see it, I immediately am intimidated by it, because at first, it kind of says that you're just a painter. And I'm a painter, so that's, that would be intimidating. So after I get over my insecurities, then I can initially very quickly get onto what I like about Daniel's work. And looking at his work, for me, it always has me, after a short period of time, questioning my own motivations that we all deal with globally, what's happening. But for me, it keeps coming back to taking a look at considering the structures around me, both physical, metaphysical, intellectual structures that also include my own body. And usually after considering his work for a while, somehow I always feel like a better painter. I don't know if that makes any sense, but that happens whenever I see his work, and you're going to have a chance to experience his work yourself when you go to the gallery. I have to mention this too. In 1993, Daniel created a work for the Whitney Biennial. Those admitted to the museum wore a badge, like a museum badge you get as you enter the museum. Each badge bore part or all of a phrase, "I can't imagine ever wanting to be white." This pissed off a number of people. I was there at the opening, and it was a shocker for some people when they saw that just part of their badge added up to this statement. A lot of people just didn't know how to deal with it. You know, we wanted Daniel to be our artist in residence some years ago. We invited him to be here, and he had just too many shows going on, so it really didn't work out for a while. At that time, a noted art historian and art critic and author asked me who the artist in residence was going to be, and I said, "We were trying to get Daniel J. Martinez." He said, "Martinez, that guy really ticks me off. You know, he gets under my skin, he knows how to push my buttons. He gets under my skin and he drives me crazy." A few months ago, the same noted art world person asked me who the artist in residence was going to be, and I backed up a few paces. And I said, "Well, you know, we're pretty excited that it's, and you may not be, it's Daniel J. Martinez." He said, "Daniel Martinez, that's great, I love him." And I said, "I thought he got under your skin and ticked you off and drove you crazy." He said, "I love when he does that." That's also a big part of Daniel's work, and soon you will be able to have Daniel get under your skin as well. And by the way, I'm not mentioning any names, but I'm looking for her. She probably remembers that. The other side of Daniel, that you'll also experience tonight is that he's one of the finest and most dedicated educators that you'll ever meet. He has guided so many young artists to really successful careers that people queue up to take his class at UC Irvine. Our students are already finding out what a dedicated teacher he is. As Alex mentioned, the poor guy comes in to install his show on Friday. Next thing you know, he's teaching a three-hour class and had to be stopped at that because he would continue. Our students are really good at taking advantage of a giving person. So, Daniel's in for more of that because of his willingness to share. So I'll close it out soon, but Daniel for me is a rare, authentic, and independent soul. And authentic is good for me. Independent. Independent soul means independent artist as well. It's just who Daniel is. I've known him for a number of years, and from time to time we talk. Recently we talked on the phone, and we spent some time kvetching. This is lighthearted complaining. Write the word down, but it sounds right. So after a conversation like this, you'd probably feel that maybe we were a little bummed out. But the thing with Daniel Martinez, any conversation I have with him, no matter what the topic of the conversation is, I always leave feeling better about myself, better, believe it or not, better about the world, and stronger in my commitment to my art. He always kind of leaves me feeling that we can all make a difference through our art. And it's a responsibility that we have. He's a pure artist, and this ability that I'm talking about comes from the soul, and you'll experience it. Daniel does, he does great titles to his work, and some people who have interviewed him recently said, "He has these long answers to these questions." I said, "Yes, but they cut through a lot of stuff." He's doing a workshop here, a class for a selected group of students at PCC. We have now gone 15 people over our limit, so the class is closed. But the class is everything you ever wanted to know about art, artists, graduate school, galleries, theory, reading, and anything else you can think of, but were afraid to ask. Or a new taste of something both sweet and sour and bittersweet. He flips time around and just has you looking at everything differently. But not everything is long. I probably shouldn't say this, but what the heck. We were in the same building for a number of years. And see, Daniel doesn't always give long answers. And sometimes he can just cut right to it. And this is a real heady thing that happened here. But there was somebody in the building. And acting eccentric, I said, leaving strange notes, complaining about people, and just driving everybody a little nuts. And I remember talking to Daniel about what's going on with this guy. What is his motivation? What's his problem? And he said, Jim, he's nuts. So sometimes that's right to the point, and that helped out a great deal. Listen, Daniel Martinez is a brilliant, Daniel Joseph Martinez is a brilliant artist. He's a committed educator. I'm going to say he's my friend, but he also did this book. I almost forgot the book. This is new. Daniel J. Martinez, A Life of Disobedience. We have it, and you can get it. You know where you can get it. You can get it on Amazon. But anyway, no more embarrassment, Daniel. And I don't want to blow your, what a lot of people have for you, your bad boy, persona. But he's a great guy, independent thinker, and I think a great American artist, Daniel Joseph Martinez.
Not to say that the two of you didn't put extra pressure on what I was going to do already, so thank you for that. But I'd like to welcome you all here. I appreciate you taking the time to come to hear a few thoughts I have on the subject of art and perhaps a few thoughts on a couple other things. It is an honor for me to be here as Alex said, the 25th. You never had told me that before, that I'm the, so I like that, a quarter of a century, you know, it has some 25 years old, there's some things in there that sort of make sense. So I'm the 25th, so I thought that was a nice note, but no, it's really, it's a pleasure to be here, it's a pleasure to speak to you, to be able to work with the students over the next week, over this week, and hopefully there might be a few surprises. You never know. You never know what happens in class, and or what a class is, actually. Class is not what you think it is always, but I do have a few thank yous also. I'd like to thank Alex very much and the art department for the generosity in inviting me here. It's very much appreciated. I understand what you said about the program and what it's done for this school, and so very much appreciated. I'd like to thank Jim and Brian both. Have been extraordinarily supportive of me in every single way from the very minute that they asked me to be here and to up to right this second. Dennis Callwood, God damn. Brother, my brother, I haven't seen you for a long time. Damn, okay. I also would like to thank Charles, the installer, and Ray, who were also Brian's class, who helped me install the work or deconstruct the work or something. I mean, they were great help. I mean, it was one way or another, so it was fabulous. And but Charles and Ray both, you know, they're extremely good preparators and efficient and accurate, which is it's hard to find people that can accomplish that actually. So anyway, I thank you all for coming, and I thank everybody for being here right now. It's difficult sometimes to, I'll put this another way too. It's not possible for me in the next 45 minutes, hour, to really tell you anything about myself or what I do. Actually, it's the other way around, more to tell you about what I do as opposed to myself. But because I cannot collapse in such a short period of time a lifetime's worth of thinking about and concentrating on a set of questions that have the possibility of becoming propositions were based on a set of ethics and ideologies that surround the idea of art. So all the best I can do for you now is sort of like a little sample or a little taste, but it's, I always somehow feel it's inadequate because it doesn't extend itself to the place that I would prefer. And so anyway, that's kind of where I'm going with what we're gonna see here. I have lots of discussions with lots of colleagues practically all over the world, because you can either Skype or, I mean, there's a million ways you can talk to people in Moscow, and it's like cheap, right? There's a discussion that is happening globally amongst a group of artists, a group of intellectuals, art historians, people in the field. And what that, it was difficult for a long time to pin down exactly what it was that was sort of nagging at us about what has transpired between the 19th, 20th, and 21st century. There was like a piece missing in terms of the evolutionary transition of who we are, what we are, how we exist, cohabitate, and behave on this planet. And I couldn't, for the longest time, I just couldn't pin it down. First, I thought perhaps it's a generational issue, that it's different generations have difficulty in transmitting different kinds of ideas so that they will sort of cross over a particular ravine, right? So the easiest example is that those of us that were born in the analog world, pencils and X-Acto knives and rulers, some of us were able to make it across the digital divide. And, you know, we got lucky, to be honest. And a lot of dear friends were not able to make it. So they got trapped into a place which trapped is probably a little strong, but it's when you don't have enough elbow room, right, to move, to think. You need space to think. You can't think in a closet. Like, this would be a perfect studio. Tear everything out of here, nice high ceilings, tear up the walls, it'd be great. You know, have my own projection for little parties late at night. But you need space to think for your mind. Because if you don't have that space to think, it becomes claustrophobic, and in your mind stops functioning. And thinking, if it wasn't generational, what could it be? Well, this is arguable. It's arguable that the three most significant revolutions that have ever taken place are, would go something like this. I would say the French Revolution, I would say the American Revolution, and I would say the Industrial Revolution. And this was, when I narrowed it down to these three factors, it just like bang. It just finally, 11 years into the 21st century, it took that long to be able to sort it out in relation to the mode of operation of what it is that we call artists, or who we call artists, and the field that they work in, and the art world that they exchange their ideas in. Because there have been tremendous changes that have taken place in the past 20 years that no one could have imagined would have happened. Paul Virilio, who is a well-known writer, wrote a book called Speed, and he and probably 10, 15 years ago had anticipated and discussed how time is going to alter itself. Time is not about 1, 2, 3 in terms of learning or living or experience any longer. Time and the way that we behave and learn is exponential now. So there are quantum leaps. In the 19th and 20th century, the quantum leaps are still confined to very specific geopolitical constructs. But in the 21st century, something happened, which is the fourth revolution, which is the technological revolution, the digital revolution. And now, while that seems so easy to understand, like, you know, everyone's got an iPhone, some kind of cell phone, computer, I mean, like, on the surface, we all understand how technology aids us in our lives. That's fairly obvious. But what, I mean, just finishing having a discussion with a friend of mine in Prague, that what we have not done yet is to unpack what the actual effect of being in a technological era has done to us as individuals, as human beings, right? Everything that you knew is not gone, it's just obsolete. It's just obsolete. So in other words, we have created a sort of bubble within a bubble, okay? The outer bubble was what I say we intellectually exist in the 19th century. We are aesthetically trapped in the mid-20th century. And then when the 21st century came, nothing. Like a big zero. Nothing. Flat as a board. Nothing has happened in the first 10 years of this century that I would tell my mother was worth telling her about. You know, it's like, and I don't mean that to be disrespectful or as to sound as harsh of a critique as it is. It's just simply, and this is what caused this conversation. Well, what exactly are we doing? And what we're doing is we do not understand that the level of technology has affected us down to the genetic level. Okay, so let me put this the other way. So what is the most pressing issue? What is the most germane and important subject that needs to be discussed by all individuals at every generation that would be relevant enough to actually alter and change a way that they think about something, right? To genuinely go somewhere we have not been. So what I'm, what I'm doing and what I'm going to continue to do is sort of focus on the artists of the 21st century. What does it mean to be an artist in the 21st century? See, we still think that an artist in the 21st century is the same as being an artist in the late 20th century, because everything is the same. Nothing has changed. You still have critics, you still have artists, you have galleries, you have the marketplace, which is, I have no problem with the market. The market was inevitability. That's a flat discussion as far as I'm concerned. We live in a capitalist world, so you know, I tell people just get over it. Like, it was inevitable that art was gonna move in that direction. The most significant thing that has happened is, and it's unacknowledged, I mean, basically the art world's operation is all the same. We just happen to be in the 21st century. We have all this technology. We have this new way of thinking, a really new way of thinking, and we have yet to take advantage of it, probably except for the predominance of young people in the room. And that happens to be, as artists, I could probably ask anyone in the room that was an artist, what are the basic sets of tools that you use in order to create your work? So, you know, obviously one of those tools is your intellect in creating ideas. Another is a particular skill level, your ability to manifest and translate, transform, mutate, to alter and sort of metaphysically put people in a place that they do not recognize, that they do not understand, right? Instead of being afraid of what you don't understand, what happens if you were to embrace it? Because currently when there is something that we are afraid of, we usually kill it first. And then we think about what we just killed and wonder why we killed it, because maybe, it's like if aliens come right now, I guarantee you they're gonna shoot them out of the sky. They're not gonna ask them if they're friendly first, okay? And so what has not been pointed out that I have heard of, and if I'm in the dark, please someone tell me. But it has to do with the tools that artists use in the 21st century are a completely and categorically paradigmatic shift from what occurred in the 20th century to what occurs in the 21st century. There is absolutely nothing that can be compared between the two paradigms. The only thing that has been dragged from one paradigm to the other paradigm is our inheritance and the habits that we have about staying within the same rituals, trajectories, systems, operations, institutional confines, the academic, the means of distribution, the critical discussion of art by art critics, art writers, cultural writers. So we're using basically a 20th century model in the 21st century. And it makes no sense. A simple way to put this, if you had a Mac, say from 1989, do you really think that you could put software from 2011 on it? It doesn't work. The operating system is no longer compatible with the hardware. And this is the perfect metaphor for me to, for us to try to understand the ravine that has sort of, that has been created between us. It's like, we're using the wrong tools. We're not thinking in a way that expands the possibilities of our existence. But what we're doing is, we're just floating along in the status quo because, you know, this is America. Everything's good here, right? It's a one big happy family, and you know, like, we just love each other. You know, it's just like fabulous. Go to Starbucks when we're after, and go down to some place on Colorado and get a nice dinner. You know, it's like go home and you know, watch a stream a movie. You know, I mean, there's. So this discrepancy is part of what began this thinking in this session. What is the 21st century artist? So I know that time's an issue. I'm gonna read. There's two things I want to read you, and then we'll move on to the images. I want to read you something that I used to profoundly believe. I'm a by all accounts, you know, an idealist, a utopianist. An anarchist, a romantic, you know, like I'm old school, but I have no problem operating in the new school, okay? It's just fine and dandy, it's no problem. I made it over the ravine, it's cool, I get it, okay? The text helped me a little bit with some, you know, tricks that I don't know, because there's not enough time. There's not enough time to read all the books I want to read. There is not enough time to read all the books I want to read. So you have to, I have piles, and you get to them when you get to them, right? So I'm going to begin with this, and even if this is just a position that has been argued that I believe is not only accurate, but I think it was visionary at the time in terms of an articulation of a social geopolitical existence of us as human beings. Okay, that's a lot in one thing, but nonetheless, okay? So Hegel, who's a philosopher, Hegel said, philosophy was time comprehended in, Hegel said philosophy was time comprehended in thought, and that art, up to the modern age, was the way culture made sense of their community through images. Modern society can no longer think seriously about itself by making single images, single pictures, or in fact, in any way that we have made images in the past. Modern society is too inward on one hand and too abstract on the other hand to be able to condense the contemporary experiences of the 21st century into an idea that we call art. So see, we are starting the 21st century with both an advantage and a disadvantage. We have the tools, but we have not solved Hegel's problem. This is a challenge to solve. What do you do if you cannot embed philosophically, intellectually, aesthetically, what it is that you aspire to in your work? Well, we have a lot to talk about then, because there's a big disconnect between what is it we think we're doing and what is it we're really doing. Okay, that's hold that thought. We'll be for just another moment. Adorno, another philosopher, asked, "Is there a need for art?" This question, even though people think this question is rudimentary and generally make fun of it, I suggest any of you those that are going to be artists, you need to ask this question your entire life: Is there a need for art? And why are you making art? why are you making art? Not the him, her, them, the them, but you individually. Why? Because if you ask that question and you look in the mirror and try to be honest with yourself, you might not be able to look at the image very long. Because what we do is we tend to distort and to want to deny the comfort of where we are in lieu of the reality that exists around us, right? It's much better to deny. I mean, any psychiatrist or therapist will tell you that. I mean, denial is the easiest way to go, man. That didn't happen. You know, I didn't kill those people. I didn't rob the store. I didn't do any of those things. Somebody else did them, right? I'm off the hook. And then if you believe in any particular religion, you know, I just got a penance and I'm good. I'm saved, you know, like it's salvation is just around the corner. A few Hail Marys and a couple rosaries and you're all good, you know. But in Christian religion. So Adorno asks, is there a need for art? If so, what is that need? This question is how art and art history connect. Art provides unique sensors, experience, and particularities that give us empathy as an experience, in addition to an acknowledgement of our humanity, of the world that we live in. Empathy and humanity. These are two words that we live in a society that I very rarely hear, much less to move into a discussion of ethics. If we have lost our ability for empathy, we have lost our ability for compassion, that means that we are now as human beings, and we no longer have the ability to genuinely understand our humanity in tangent with the other individuals that you coexist with, we now have another problem. So Adorno challenges us, and then, I mean, Hegel challenges us, and now Adorno puts the rubber to the road. What does it mean when you interact with other individuals, right? And how does that work? And so one more author, Benjamin, another philosopher. So I'm reading theoretical math now, so I've moved on. I'm not just reading art, you know. Benjamin suggests the problem of modernity is the loss of experience. This one is very, very important. Benjamin suggests the problem of modernity is the loss of experience. We have lost the experience for empathy, compassion, and humanity. But more importantly, we are now getting to the point where we're losing the memory of that first enterprise. In other words, there was a time when ethics, morals, principles, values, the qualities of things that made us who we are as individual human beings. So that at one point in time, I can't actually say when it was, because I might not have experienced it, but I know that it was there. If that is the past, and we've come to the point where we no longer remember what took place in the past, we are now two steps removed from having any thought that would help aid us in navigating in the world that we exist in. Because if we continue at the rate that we are moving, that loss is not going to, that loss of memory will soon just disappear. It'll be gone. Absolutely vanish right in front of you. And you know, they can do all the archiving they want in the world. You know, and I don't care who does it, which is a good project, you know, but how does one genuinely translate and communicate and pass on experience? Really, real experiences that people have in their lives. At one time, this might have been through storytelling, but nobody tells any stories anymore, so, you know, they go online. There's a different vocabulary, there's a different language. We've become, from the 20th century to the 21st century, we were a monolingual society. I don't mean in verbal language, but in terms of the operation of our existence in society, in the 20th century, we were a monolingual society. And what has happened is, now that we're in the 21st century, we're a bilingual society. except that we sort of have difficulty in remembering what that means. So what I did is I asked myself this question: what is the difference between the tools used in the 20th century and the tools used in the 21st century? And what is the difference between those two sets of tools? So let's just see. What I tried to do was list everything that I could think of that has basically transpired in the shift of the millennia that actually is a fundamental tool that we use. So these are the contemporary tools of the contemporary artist in this century, and we have failed to recognize it at any level. At any level. Either educationally, in the gallery, in the museum, in the writing about art, we have, it's as if it didn't exist. What do people have now? Cable, okay, satellite, web access TV, laptops, real-time streaming of films on all capable devices that can do that. Cell phones, smartphones, DVD, Blu-ray, games, portable and stereo, immersive game environments, MP3, iPods, iPads, e-readers. How do I get that? Down, got it. No, oh, there, yeah. E-readers, credit cards, real-time two-way video and audio, ATMs, digital cameras, still cameras that have the capability of producing industrial standard quality images for video that they are using on TV and that they're using in the construction of film. You tell somebody that in the 20th century, they'd laugh at you. There's just no such thing. It didn't exist. These things didn't exist in the way they exist in the combination now. Scanners, that's one. Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. Those, whether anyone is willing to admit it or acknowledge it or not, those are the new tools. And I for so long, it wasn't a resistance to the fact that these tools existed, because I for a long time thought it was generational, but it's not. It has to do with a new form of encryption and a new language that has to be understood in order for us to combine the analog and the digital in a way so that we can actually move forward as human beings, as opposed to remaining static in the same place. So these tools, if these are the new tools of the 21st century artist, that means that you have to be able to understand what they do and what they do to us and how that is actually going to change art making. I'm not talking about digital art. I'm not talking about doing something on the web. I'm talking about, at the most fundamental level, what we refer to, would be, the simplest is social networking, right? Social networking, in a sense, sums up this list. So, a remarkable thing happens in Egypt. They have a revolution, a nonviolent revolution, by social networking. I just read in the New York Times today that the Palestinians are adopting the same model and trying to negotiate at a different level with the Israelis. See, the idea of social networking, the idea of having instantaneous information, this is what is the most remarkable thing of the 21st century that we do not understand. Young people, I would say, understand it, and I'm not even sure they completely understand it. You know that with like 5 keystrokes, I can look up anything in the world. There is nothing, there is no information out of my reach. You actually have to take a second to consider what I know that it's taken for granted now, but just consider it for a second. What does it mean? You can walk up to your computer, I don't care what you know or don't know, if you just bang, 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 and it's like, boom, information is there about anything. That's as if God had touched you on the head and said, you were like, you're God, you know everything. And it's like, but we don't recognize it yet. We don't understand it yet, because the effect of these tools on art has changed art completely, 100%. And I'll tell you in the simplest way. If, in fact, these are the tools of the 21st century to make art, that means what we used to call the authentic experience of art, which is the actual personal viewing of a work of art, to having an interaction and experience with that work of art was important. You would see the real art. You're looking at a Rothko, you know, you're looking at a Pollock, you're looking at, it doesn't matter who you want to talk about. But it's the impression of standing in front of that work and in the exchange of what happens that is the connective tissue between the artists and the public. Because it's about those experiences and the loss of those experiences that I was speaking about earlier. So if that's the case, and this box is the new tool, that means basically you never see an image bigger than that. If you want to make it full screen, that's fine. But that means most of the time now, everybody sees all art that's about 2 inches wide. I know people look at movies on their cell phones. Like, there was a reason to go to a movie theater, but I know lots of people that laugh at me, say, I can watch it on my cell phone just as easy, right? That means that we are again, one step removed from a type of experience that could affect you to the flattening out of a human experience into, yes, an extraordinarily powerful device, but what it doesn't have, or that I'm unaware that it has, it doesn't have a soul. It doesn't have the qualities yet that allow it to interact with us as human beings in a way that would aid us rather than separating us. There was another article in the New York Times, I think it was on Sunday, it showed a person on the New York subway, and she had her earphones on and was on her iPhone, and the title was, "We're All Together Alone." I go to cafes, you know, you would normally go to a cafe, visit somebody, or hang out with them. Every minute, no one's talking in the cafes. They're all like this, right? You go to dinner with someone, that's my favorite. You take someone out to dinner, right? Just love this. I mean, you're on a date or whatever, take someone, and they go, excuse me for a second, I just gotta send one email, like that. Oh, I gotta do one text, one something. It's like, wow, you're kidding me. You won't have dinner? You won't spend like an hour or 2 hours with me and have dinner and not shove that thing in your hand and make something happen? No, it's because people are completely addicted. It's a prosthetic. The new technology is a prosthetic that has been unknowingly integrated into our lives, into our system. And that is something that's probably perhaps the most important thing that we need to unpack and to realize what has happened, because you know, I don't really care if everyone in the world knows that I'm an artist, to be perfectly honest. I actually, it's not my intention to talk to the world. It's not my intention to be known on the whole world. It's not my intention to save the world. It's not my intention to destroy the world. It's not my intention to be famous. It's not my intention to disseminate my images this big that I spent a lifetime building, but yet I have to accept the fact that that language is the language that controls us. So if that is true, if you believe what I'm saying, that means that because of instantaneous access to everything, so anything that's happening right now, it's online right now, okay? That means that the modes of thinking ideologically, the ideas we have, the apparatuses that we use to construct our art, and the means by which to disseminate them have to be understood from a genuinely different access point. We have to move the geography in our mind to understand what the contemporary art world is doing with the contemporary tools that it uses. See, that's not a generation gap. That is a paradigm shift. That's why I would move in and say that the fourth revolution is the technological, the information age, right? Or as Silvère Lotringer, who is a French philosopher, he said it calls information bomb, you might say, has been dropped on us, and we're a little naive, to be honest. We don't want to recognize the enormous power that exists there, because it's extremely dangerous. It's like freedom. Everybody wants to be free. Freedom's dangerous. Freedom is absolutely necessary. Autonomy, independent thinking. But when people have freedom, which I will demonstrate to you, when people have freedom, they interpret freedom, I would say in general, as a generalization, in the wrong way. Freedom does not mean you get to do anything you want. That's not freedom. Freedom is the ability to move independently or within communities or within whatever construct is the environment that you live and work in. So, example, this community is this university, okay? And it is the faculty that are a cohort, and it's the students, and it's the relationships, it's the administration. These are groups of people that are interacting together in order to... See, institutions are nothing without people. They're just the buildings. And as I said the other day when I was talking with the class, there's a misnomer about education. Students believe that we as teachers are responsible for your education. That's not actually true. It's not actually true. We are guides in order to expose you to information. But your actual education is your responsibility, not my responsibility, or Jim's, or anybody else's. Because if you are not participating in an equal, if you are not working like a civil society should function, where there's a give and take between both entities, and you just take. That's what we do. We take, we take, we take, we take, we take. And we get left with an empty shell. Again, all of what was being discussed earlier, the loss of empathy, compassion, humanity. And those are the three things that are absolutely mandatorily necessary to make art. I guess what I'm attempting to... The reason that I am speaking to you first before showing you images is that I'm trying to sort of carve a path so that you understand something about the trajectory that I believe is not only mandatory, but the necessity of it for us to be able to retain those things that make us human beings. Because quite honestly, if you look at the state of the world that we are in right now, I would be hard pressed to look at any piece of information coming from any country in the world and say that those are not barbarians, including us. What does it mean when the entire world is at war and we don't call it a war? What does that mean, right? We had Iraq, you know, had Afghanistan. Oh, did you forget? We have the Libyan war now. That's actually great. Every war that we've had since World War II, or maybe the Korean War, has not been officially declared war. It is always just a thing you do, right? It's not real war. It's like, we're going to go to war with this guy. It's like, oh, we're going to fight it out anyway, but we're never going to call it war, right? That's a huge distinction. That's a very important distinction. So whoever said that, they're right on the money. So let's see if I can do this now. Command F.
Perhaps we've misunderstood Likes. Her all along. Maybe she's been operating on a much higher plane than the rest of us. And instead of honking the waterfowl of Lake Lucille as her backdrop, all she really needed was the soft beat of a bongo drum and mood lighting. Our number two story, Sarah Palin, Alaska beat poet. Last night... on the Tonight Show, Conan tested out the theory that Palin's erratic speeches are not just random thoughts, but rather one way that the former governor channels her inner Allen Ginsberg. First, her own words as a speech, and then as performance art.
And getting up here, I say it is the best road trip in America, soaring through nature's finest show. Denali, the great one, soaring under the midnight sun. The cold, though, doesn't it split the chichacos from the sourdoughs? We find me blooming along the frost heaves and merciless rivers that are rushing and...
I'm going to read the Palin speech verbatim as it was intended to be heard. It's Emmy Award winner and master thespian, Mr. William Shatner.
Yeah. Captain Kirk. Captain Kirk.
Thank you. soaring through the ages by the sun. Denali, the great one, soaring under the midnight sun. And then the extremes in the wintertime. It's the frozen road that is competing with all of its vice fog frigid beauty. The cold, though, doesn't it split the chichacos from the sourdough? And then in the summertime, such extremes, summertime, about 150 degrees hotter than just some months ago, and then just some months from now. The fire we blooming along the frost heaves and merciless rivers that are rushing and carving and reminding us that here Mother Nature wins. And it is as throughout all Alaska, that big, wild, good life teeming along the road that is north to the future.
Yes, okay. Lights, okay. Now that, if... It doesn't matter, in my opinion, it doesn't really matter what side of the aisle you're on. That's just great. I mean, Captain Kirk reading Ginsberg-style beat poetry of Sarah Palin. Wow. I don't know what it means, but it's fantastic. You know, it's just, like, great, okay? So, okay, so I'm going to, we will move on. And now I will... I will attempt to. I'm gonna attempt to do something right now. I'm actually not sure what it is, but okay. So I spoke recently at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Look at this thing that I had to sign. It says Article 11, Section 5, and Article 15, Section 2 of the Constitution of the State of Nevada. Require all academic faculty, including part-time faculty and graduate assistants with instructional responsibility, to subscribe to the oath specified below. Note, professional non-academic staff and faculty participating in foreign exchange programs, typically on a J-1 visa, are not required to subscribe to the oath. Faculty on an H-1B visa or permanent residency are required to subscribe to the oath. The oath must be subscribed to before a notary or other notarial, no, I can't even say the word, officer, such as a justice of the peace, or a judge, okay, and may be executed in any jurisdiction prior to employment. Daniel Joseph Martinez, do solemnly swear, I affirm that I will support and protect and defend the Constitution and the government of the United States, and the Constitution and the government of the State of Nevada, against all enemies, whether domestic or foreign, and that I will bear true faith, allegiance, and loyalty, loyalty, to the same, any ordinance, resolution, or law, any state, notwithstanding, and that I will well and faithfully perform these duties of the office of visiting artist, on which I am about to enter, okay? They wouldn't let me come till I had that piece of paper sent to them. I thought, I've talked in more places than I can tell you. I've never heard of such a thing. Can you believe that? For a talk about art. Wow, that was just totally unbelievably remarkable, okay? So, this is, I show this image because this is perhaps a novel but fairly good example of what the 21st century's tools are able to do, which is that anything that you think, anything that you make, anything that is said, behavior, doesn't matter what it is, the second it exists, it is monetized. And do people know what the word monetized means? I don't see. Monetization is when you take a particular product and you maximize your profit from that product. It's generally done in economics and banking, But it's also done with what we call merchandising. So she dies, and look at the first thing that happens. You can buy the commemorative Life magazine in whatever year this was, in 1932 to 2011 of Elizabeth Taylor. Okay, so that's a co-optation. It guts the actual experience of actually thinking and knowing. Some of us perhaps know Elizabeth Taylor much differently than others of you, but there's something. It's not that it bothers me, but it bothers me. Okay? It's like I'm on the edge of this because it exists and there's nothing I can do about it. This perhaps is, you know, it's very difficult to understand. I mean, I don't understand anything anymore, actually, but the world is like sort of like gone bananas, you know. This Gaddafi at one point was our friend. He was our good buddy, and we gave him money. We trained their soldiers. We gave them weapons. We gave them infrastructure. We gave them everything they wanted. Now, nobody likes him. See, that's like your uncle, you know, the uncle in the family, you don't want to come to Christmas dinner. It's like, what happened in over those years? What really, I mean, what happened, you know? I mean, what? He farted at the wrong time or, you know, sneezed his nose on the dinner table. I mean, you know, what's the problem? Why don't we like him anymore, okay? And then move to this. How many times in history have you seen this image? Anybody name me the first place this image probably comes to mind. What's that? I'm sorry. Yeah, what's the place though? Iwo Jima. Perfect. Excellent. What's another one? Just come to mind. I mean, this image of people standing on a platform of victory after winning, so-called winning, some kind of revolution or war. What's that? Nitroglycerin? I can't hear, I'm sorry.
French Revolution.
What's that? Yeah, that could be possible. Yep. It also happened in Iraq when they brought Saddam Hussein. It also happened in Russia when they brought down Stalin. So this image is a perpetual image of hope. But it's not real hope, because this is now is a construct to make us believe that there's hope, because it's a posed image for the media, for those embedded photographers. Because the images are not true. There's nothing true about images. They're lies. They're meant to be lies. You know, what's that saying that politicians use the truth to tell lies, and artists use lies to tell the truth? I don't know if that's true or not, but I like it. So then we go to this. Anybody, it would be a wild guess if anybody got it. Anybody know who that is? God damn, that's good. That is great. Yes, Charles Darwin, Theory of Evolution. I'm working on now organizing, and it's going to take 2 years, but I'm going to pick up the voyage of the Beagle at the Terre de France, where they stopped, because I can't do the transatlantic part of it. But I'm going to start in Terre de Fuego and follow the exact path of Darwin to try to not see what he saw, but try to understand how the revelation or the epiphany or how the dots got connected for him to take a quantum leap in a way of trying to have us understand what evolution is. It's a fact. So the thing is, and it's too bad he's not alive now, because if you talk to somebody like Virilio or a scientist named Ray Kurzweil, for example, who was a futurist, they would tell you that Darwin was good, but Darwin just didn't get it because of the way that technology advances. Technology doesn't advance, like I said earlier, in one step at a time. It advances in quantum leaps. But nonetheless, I'm going to follow Darwin for around for 6 months or so, and I don't know, might be interesting. Or I might die at sea, you know? This image just came out of the New York Times, as I thought, isn't it interesting? Because this is what social networking is doing. Social networking is influencing people to utilize and to think differently, which sort of is true and not true. But this picture is extraordinary, actually. It's just as fake as all the other pictures. But the Palestinians prayed near Israel soldiers on Friday. They were protesting land confiscation in the village of Kusara near Nablus. I pronounced both of those wrong. But there is a intention and a motivation here, because I'm sure this happened, okay? If the tools of the 21st century, if we have realized that this is possible, that Egypt was possible, I'm not saying that those are solutions, because in every revolution, the so-called bad guys get replaced by more bad guys. The revolutionaries become the bad guys, and the bad guys become the revolutionaries, and just... There's not been a single revolution that's ever succeeded that I'm aware of in this planet. But this is an influence directly from what has been taking place in recent events. And if it's true that the way the computer functions, that it can be viral, that means that there's a possibility that the new tools of the 21st century can completely change the way we are in a positive way, not leaving behind what we are, not forgetting our past, not pretending we're someone we're not, but adding to. It's an additive process, not a subtractive process. Again, being able to take advantage of those tools, right? This is my favorite, this is a favorite photo of mine, and I always show it just because, this is Mike Davis, who wrote a book called The City of Quartz. Some of you might be familiar with it. He also wrote a book called Ecology of Fear. He also wrote Buddha's... Mike Davis is a good friend of mine. He's a brilliant. He's absolutely brilliant. All he does is write, and his writing is motivated by attempting to speak about history in a way that he believes is honest. Okay, now, that can be contested. But if you compare what Mike Davis says about history and you look at the way historians talk about history, we find a rather big gap between the two. So he's trying to at least try to put something in the gap to say maybe there's more than one perspective on the circumstance that you're looking at. So he used to write for the LA Times, and the title to this picture said, "Let Malibu Burn." And what this was a picture of Malibu when it was on fire, which happens every year, because Malibu is in a place where nature burns itself off as a natural process every year. That's what it does. Every year, all these people get burned out of their houses. And what they do is they go to the city, ask the city to fix everything for them. And what he did is he made an argument that said, why should the upper 0.25% of the wealthiest people in this city get to live in a place that burns itself down and everybody else has to pay for their luxury every time it burns down? Now, of course, he's right, and he lost his job. So that's the proof of something, though. How far are you willing to go? What are you willing to risk? What are you really willing to risk to achieve what's your goals in life? Doesn't matter what they are. Really, what are you willing to risk? What are you willing to give up? To not be sort of in the sort of anesthetized, lethargic, I don't give a fuck kind of world, but to one where you actually have a pointed reason for existing in this world, a reason to exist in this world. Because being born is not enough. I'm sorry. I didn't ask to be born, but I'm here. But the only question that needs to be addressed is simply this. Between the time you were born and the time you die, the only question that exists, the most important question that exists, what are you going to do with the time in between? You're going to fuck off, or are you going to really do something? That's your choices, right? But, I would prefer people to contribute. This is great. This is when they had the Louise Bourgeois show at MoCA, and this is just fabulous. So you have Louise Bourgeois looking down at Alicia Silverstone. Alicia Silverstone is naked on her side by some water, on some grass. I'm Alicia Silverstone, and I'm a vegetarian. Wow. I mean, nudity, vegetarian, and a 100-year-old woman, one of the greatest artists in this country, in the world, put together, that's just pure beauty. I mean, you can't make that up. The only way that you get that is when it happens in daily life, and daily life is the best, in a way, kind of the best art you're ever going to experience. This is my another favorite. This is Dolly. I'm sure most of you know. But what you might not know is ever since Dolly has been, developed, but cloned is the correct word. There's a company in Colorado for $25,000. They will take a sample of the DNA of your animal and put it on cryo. And so when your dog or your pet or your fish, your cat, whenever they die, you just ring them up, tell them to make you a new one. Just like that. No problem. In fact, the best part of that is I thought if you could make one, well, you know, maybe I want two now. Like twins. I could have them make twins for me. Or like in the movies, maybe I want 10 of the same. And you could go around walking them, like, you know, and they're pulling you along like this, right? God, wouldn't that be amazing? 10 of your own dogs, identical, be great. Now, I don't know what exactly to say about this other than this is part of the transition that I was discussing earlier between what I believe. There are actually lines that should not be crossed, to be perfectly honest. Now, I am in the minority in this position. I will be, you know, frank with you. I'll be candid with you. I know half these people up here are good friends of mine. I, for the life of me, have not got a single answer of any intelligence out of any one of them as to why they did this, except that they got paid and they got made more famous to do this, to make an ad for trash. I mean, I get it. You want to be famous. Everybody needs money. Fine. It's not the issue. But are you really willing to demean yourself to this level? Is there no limit to how far you'll grovel on the ground for money? Money just paper. It's nothing. Fame. Andy Warhol said you get 15 minutes. Nah. In this world, you get 15 seconds. So forget it. It's just not going to happen. This is troubling to me. This, though, is a nuclear fallout map of the incident that just happened in Japan. You all should be worried. Because 6 days, we're toast. I mean, just think about that. That's not me making that up. That's like, I think they call them scientists, you know? But you know what's extraordinary? In all the discussion of what has taken place in Japan, and again, I'm always open for any correction or any additional information that anyone has. Because I'm by no means right on anything that I've said. I just am sort of sharing, exchanging some information with you. But nobody has mentioned that Japan is the only place that has had two nuclear disasters. Two nuclear disasters. And it happens to be this one. Okay, no one has mentioned that the United States dropped two nuclear bombs on Japan, creating incalculable amount of destruction. And the same country is the one that has a problem with an earthquake, a tsunami, and a nuclear reactor out of control. I mean, that's not just bad luck. That's like, there's something wrong. Again, there's something wrong. You see, there's always something wrong, no matter where I read, no matter what I look. And it's not that I can solve it, because I cannot. But the frustration is that I feel helpless. And in feeling helpless, the only avenue that I have in order to do what I do, whatever that is to make art. Because I believe that art ultimately is the last line of defense for the consciousness of this planet, for the consciousness of our species. We artists are the last line. If that line breaks, if artists disappear, or artists are controlled, or artists are censored, everything is over. The game is game over. We're all you have between the world that you're in and a complete and total global catastrophe. And it's just because people don't recognize that doesn't mean it's not true. Do not underestimate that which is not given the accolades and the sort of the notoriety to suggest that its evaluation of its activity or its representation is more important than it is. There are many, many things that are very, very quiet, very sublime, very noiseless, that do more than you could possibly understand. That's actually how the way works. It's like an iceberg. We only see what floats on the tip of the surface. You don't realize that there's a mountain underneath. And this is very similar to that process. I don't remember if this was New York or London, but it probably was New York. I have a propensity for stripes. Okay. How about this image? So, I don't know if any of you are fans, or any of you read science fiction of any kind, but which we're about to move to another place, but the biomechanical is no longer a myth. It is present in our lives constantly. Pacemakers is a machine. The defibrillator put in, somebody help me, the last vice president's heart, Cheney's heart. He had a little device where he hit a button and it, you know, zap him so that his heart would go again. Whoa, you know, because in case he had a heart attack, you know, like, then I'm good, right? And a couple charges and like, and like, I'm feeling great, let's go. extraordinary. I mean, think about how we have integrated technology contemporarily into our everyday lives using the tools that I identified earlier. They are part of your everyday life. Most people cannot be without their laptop, their cell phone, they cannot be without a device that connect the connectivity in the world. They cannot be without it, it's impossible. I mean, that's not everybody, but it's certainly a very large percentage of people. So if this has the possibility of coming true, then I have to turn to Nietzsche. Because I have to ask questions that are perhaps much more difficult than I am able to answer. And it began with this series, which was a series called More Human Than Human. Nietzsche, towards the end of his life, when he had, you know, he was nuts, had syphilis. I mean, he had all kinds of cool things, you know. And the very last essay he wrote, which is criticized the most, is In the Twilight of the Idols, or How to Philosophize with a Hammer. And it probably, and in my opinion, a number of people who are by far more expert, have much more expertise than I do, agree that it might be the most important thing that he had written, because he finally makes an argument for how we can change our being. And the summation of that is that he says, we must kill all of the idols and all of the gods that we worship before humanity can evolve. And that's coming from the time when we decided that there was a one God. From the very moment that they decided there was a one God, there has been killing in his name. There has been genocide around the world in the name of a God, in the name of the same God, over I don't know what. Exactly. I mean, I'm not going to get into a theological debate, but it seems strange to me. So this series, Nietzsche said that the first idol that needs to be destroyed is the ego of the self. Because the ego is what takes us down particular paths that will distort our ability to understand what is taking place around us, the reality that we live in, to comprehend it deeply, right? So this series of photos about destroying myself. So I studied everything, medical, triage, you name it, I studied it in order to make these photographs. These photographs have no Photoshop in them. There is not one bit of Photoshop in these photographs. They have not been touched by a computer. They are all hand done live performances done for the camera. So I know that by looking at some of your faces, you don't believe me, it's okay, but I'm telling you, there is no digital technology in order to make this image. Okay, let me just show you a couple more. A lot of them are based on either particularly inspiring literature to me, or paintings, or art, different artists. This happens to be a Caravaggio, a Salome, except that I reversed the direction of the characters in the painting. I mean, it's a very, very famous painting. And you know what they used to say? You know how Caravaggio got the skin tones? And you know how he was able to mix the paint in order to, I mean, Caravaggio's all about skin tone. He's all about flesh. Flesh, I mean, that's it. Caravaggio, flesh, the master of all time. He's like, you know, like. But they say how he was able to do that he had a secret. That what he would do is he would visit the morgues at night. And he'd take skins of bodies and dry them and grind them up into pigment that he would add to the already color, the paints that he was using, that helped him push one second further, one more, to make the flesh in his paintings almost supernatural, almost as if they were the actual bodies themselves. That's extraordinary. What extraordinary. I mean, there, when what's the limit? See, there's the other question about making art, where if we want to ask what the risk is, how far you're willing to risk, is there a limit that you will not go? Is there a place that you will not, will stop you? Okay? So then, did this image, this is based on a film on David Cronenberg. This is, again, I'm telling you, there's no Photoshop in these images. There is no Photoshop in these images. So I don't know what you think, but you should think past whatever it is you're thinking, because how did I make them if I didn't use Photoshop? Maybe. Can you ever see makeup that good? That doesn't. Makeup on TV is not good. Makeup and prosthetics on TV only have to last for a second, because it's action, it has narration, narrative, and it's involved in movement. So, because I know a lot of people in Hollywood that do makeup special effect thing. They're actually really hacked. I mean, they don't have to be that convincing. They just have to get through the second of the piece of film that they want to do. This is for sustained observation. This is for looking and looking and looking and looking. If you can find the artifice in this, I'll give you one. How about this? This is a reproduction of a 1969 photograph taken by Eddie Adams of an execution that took place. Eddie Adams tells a story. He says that there were a whole, you know, like a paparazzi of photographers there to take, that were thinking about taking this image. And for some reason, they actually drew an ethical line. No other photographer took this picture except for Eddie Adams. They were not willing to take a picture of, and the other thing went in 1969. Now nobody would think 2 seconds about it, but in 1969, it's like, do I want to represent an image of this level of violence? Actual violence. We're not talking about film, we're not talking about fiction, we're talking about reality. This is one human being to another, okay? Extraordinary idea. This one photograph took me 1 year to make, because the technology that made this photograph was, there's a man named Dr. Harold Edgerton, who was basically the inventor of strobe light. You would know his work, like the little drop of, the drop that goes in the milk, the bullet going through the apple, the bullet going through the balloon, all these images you probably have seen and sort of go, that sort of like now it's easy, you can do that with Photoshop, anybody can do that now with Photoshop. But Edgerton was brilliant. He actually designed machines that can flash light faster than we can do today. Because you don't need to do it today because of the development of other technologies. So, you know, these are operating at like 1/1,000,000th of a second. you know, I mean, like, so fast in order to stop things dead cold in space, in action. So what I did is his notes are available open access, so I took his notes and I rebuilt all the machines that Edgerton had used to use the photo to shoot the bullet going through the apple. So I used his machines in contemporary technology to make this photograph. And again, there's no Photoshop here. I don't know if you, this one you have to look a little further, but my tongue is cut out of this one. So what you can see is I'm slowly but surely completely dismantling my own body. I'm slowly but surely deconstructing, terrorizing it in order to somehow kill the ego and sort of put myself in the place that Nietzsche was discussing, right? This series is, I'm showing you this series first because this series was important to me in terms of a development of my very deep interest in AI, artificial intelligence, and biomechanical animal machines, and what the possibility of those are for the future. And what happened is when I got to the end of this work, I realized that this was not able to sufficiently do what I needed it to do, because it stopped at the photograph. I realized that I had to, it's not exactly the right analogy, but I had to become Frankenstein, the doctor. I had to make a construction, I had to construct a new body that was able to surpass this shell, that was had a purpose, a different purpose, right? But in the meantime, you know, when I went up to Alaska for a residency, and I had won this award for this residency. And people said, what are you going to do in Alaska? You know, it's like, it's cold, it's flat. It's like, you know, I mean, there are mountains there and all this. But it's like, I mean, has anybody been to Alaska? I see a couple hands. So I lived there for a month. It was absolutely extraordinary. But I went purposefully to look for the Yeti, okay? That was my whole goal for my whole project. I'm going to find him because I know that he exists and he lives in Alaska, you know? And I'm cool. He's got to be cool. We'll just sit down and have a conversation. And it's like, so what do you do really? What's up? Where's the rest of the family, you know? Where do you guys hang out that nobody can find you, right? And it was fantastic. He was such a nice guy. Okay, so this is the beginning of a trilogy of what I was suggesting to you earlier. This was conceived as a trilogy. These are doppelgangers. Doppelganger is a word that's to describe the exact replica of someone. In other words, the exact copy, not a clone, but an intellectual copy. Okay? So this, in essence, is me, my first attempt at making a machine. And this is I can't remember the title for the life of me. What's that? But what's the first part? It's like,
to kill a blind man.
No, yeah, but you, but for, no, it's how to kill a blind man. Is that it? Okay. She knows much better than I, because she knows everything about me, so. But anyway, so it's done in an all-white room, so it looks like an asylum. It moves on to this. It's all based on experiences. I guess people say that, you know, that Disneyland was so far advanced in terms of its technology. I mean, to do the Abraham Lincoln when they first did it, it was absolutely extraordinary. The technology, the money that was put into it, everything about it. And then you sort of moved up to date, and you have all these sort of, you know, these micro worlds that you live in when you go through Disneyland. This particular work is in the trilogy is based on Mishima, Yukio Mishima. And Mishima was an extraordinary individual. They say that he is still the most important writer in 500 years of Japanese writing history. So all the writing had been done 450 years before him. It's absolutely extraordinary that's the case. At the same time, as being this absolutely luscious and absolutely beautiful writer with words. I mean, I'm not talking about a wordsmith. I'm talking about someone that made words. It was like sex. I mean, they were like just so beautiful, so undescribable, his ability to communicate with language, right? He was also radically political because he believed that the contemporary state of Japan at the time was not holding on to its traditional values. It was exchanging its traditional values for contemporary values. And all he was arguing for, in a sense, was we're going to go forward, everybody understands that, but we're not going to leave behind what it means to be Japanese. And that's what he argued against. He started his own army. In the end, he had to commit seppuku because no one believed him. They laughed at him. So one of the greatest writers, perhaps, you know, one of the probably top 10 greatest writers in the world, commits suicide at 40. He accomplished all his writing before 40. Whoa. I mean, sure, we can go to music and talk about Bach, Beethoven, but I'm talking about writing right now. That's impressive. That's fairly impressive. I don't care who you want to go up against. Hemingway, just sort of bring him on. So anyway, this machine is programmed to commit suicide. It's programmed to kill itself. In its desire as a machine, because it has desire, but its desire is a program of desire. It has to fulfill its function. It has to fulfill its function. You know, like if you have a toaster, put toast in it, you push the thing down, toast has got to come up eventually. If it doesn't come up, you pop the thing and then the toast is there, right? I mean, there's no argument. The toaster toasts. The refrigerator makes things cold. I mean, they're just machines. But what if machines go beyond that? Okay? So this machine was designed to kill itself. It gets only so far, and then what happens is that it short circuits. Something in its programming tells it that it cannot fulfill its programming, so it rejects the program that was written for it and stops what it's doing in its attempt to kill itself. So it just goes into a strange loop of just movement. It refuses to kill itself. Now, how does a machine do that? How does a machine say no to what it's programmed to do? I don't know. It's a very interesting question. So it goes through these particular movements. This is like the first stage of suicide. This is not complete suicide, obviously. And then he looks up. He laughs a lot. So anyway, this was the first one. It was, most of the machines of this type are built with millions of dollars. In comparison, I made this with about 50 cents. So the fact that it actually even exists and worked is kind of a miracle, right? And then what do you think about that? I mean, really, if you think of Battlestar Galactica and you think of Kubrick, okay, I mean, that relationship has to, like, conjure something in relation to what I'm discussing. I mean, really, what is the story about our species and this planet? I mean, do you really believe, I mean, honestly, you really believe the Egyptians made the pyramids? Truly, I mean, come on. Or Machu Picchu, or the NASCAR lines, or Easter Island, or any number of 1,000 other things. You really think they engineered that? I don't care how many slaves they had. Think about it. Go look at somebody who is not in full belief of the technology they say they developed, and the leaps in technology and the advancement of the species. There were moments that just went like that, and it was not an evolutionary development. So where'd they get the information? Did they made it up? They thought it up? I don't think so. So it's just a question. Are we actually, I mean, I know I'm an alien. I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm not human. I never wanted to be human, actually. So I had a choice when I was coming to visit the planet that I could be human for a while, but being in this shell really, it's a little, I don't know, it's a little restrictive. So sooner or later, I'm going to get to go back, you know, to my own self. Very soon, I'm leaving very soon, so I'll let you know, because, yeah, I got to go. Anyway, this is, again, we're talking about constant reinforcement of what I am suggesting that appears every day. Time Magazine, 2045. 2045 is a very significant year. 2045, Ray Kurzweil, the scientist that I was talking to you about, he has a theory about something called GNR. He says the simultaneity of these three fields, genetics, the ability to genetically alter, nanotechnology, and the ability to build machines that are smaller than microscopic, right? Things at the level that are almost virtually impossible, but build a machine that could go into the body, fix it, and be expelled through waste. And the last R is for robotics. He predicts by 2045, computers will have the processing power of the human brain. Nobody believed that was ever going to be possible. It's absolutely possible. Not sentience, but computing power. But if you combine the three areas of study that he is interested in and makes an argument for that is, I mean, yeah, maybe he's a little off, but it's like right on off. It's like if you combine all three of those fields, it's an absolute inevitability. Because once the machines have processing power, it's only a short while before sentience will appear. Because of the combination of these three fields simultaneously taking quantum leaps into the future. So he says by 2045, I mean, forget it. The computer will be able to compute as fast as the human brain. No one has ever even dreamed that that would be possible. This is the second machine, second me that I made that this was what Jim had explained was in the Cairo Biennial. And this is obviously before some of the fun they've been having. This piece is titled Call Me Ishmael. And he also has a function. His function is that his body, regardless of the programming, is completely out of control. In other words, he is trying to destroy himself by beating himself to death. Anybody see? Everybody seen Blade Runner? Okay, do you remember towards the end of the film when Deckard is going to shoot? I think it was Pris, and he shoots her, and she goes like that. That's what this machine does in real time. You go up to it, and I've had doctors, real doctors, come up to me and say that actually with the opening at the Orange County Biennial, these two doctors of a friend of an ex-student of mine, they said that they were compelled to want to help. But they knew that there was nothing to do because it wasn't real, but they couldn't convince themselves that it wasn't real. See, there's a very interesting line that we make. What is real? Which reality do we genuinely exist in? I mean, truly. Do you believe everybody in this room is in the same reality? I don't think so. Bodies all might be here, you know, but I guarantee you that there's more than one-dimensional thinking taking place here. And that's the question. How does one expand the mind to take in the possibility that there are 10 to 12 of dimensions that exist currently? What does that mean? What are the implications of that, right? So this is him in action. Ishmael rocks on. That's him. He beats himself so hard to the ground, if you were to put your hand under his leg or his hand, it would break it. That's how much pressure is coming down onto the floor when he goes berserk. He just like an epilepsy fit, just completely lose it, completely. It's just gone. And there's no hope of being able to recuperate that circumstance, right? This image you'll find interesting. This was opening night in Cairo. And take a look at the different kinds of expressions of the different kinds of people wearing the different kinds of clothes. Look at how people look. Look at the two women with the blue and green headscarves on, right? Look at the woman with the red one, holding hands with the other one, the woman in the brown, right? Cell phone. I mean, people came up to me and told me, they asked me, is this the path to heaven? Because it's in an all-white room, an overly illuminated white room. Again, in this case, I'm wearing complete white. All you see is my skin tone. They wanted to know if this is what happens when you die. What happens when you die? Who knows? But in the culture that I was in, they had no problem taking a leap and saying that this is the possibility. I've had people come to the machine, pray around the machine, kiss its forehead as if it were was like a religious relic. I mean, some of the most extraordinary things had happened when this exhibition was on. The most extraordinary thing that happened at this event was during the course of the exhibition, I was lying there doing what I do, and the Cairo Museum doesn't have as many guards or video cameras and things like that, so if people go to visit the museum, everything is subject to, you know, sort of random activity. So somebody apparently didn't like me and jumped on my chest and caved in my rib cage. They took their thumbs and jammed them into my eyes and blinded me and attempted to decapitate me and then left me there as just a dead carcass. Like, why would you do that? Why would you do that to me? What impulse? What, you object to the technology? It's an offense against your faith. Could be, I guess, a million different reasons, but from my point of view, there's really no reason because somebody killed me. Someone killed me. That's me. I'm the machine. That was me. So I'm dead and I'm a clone because I had my, I got, you know, Colorado, man. What happens if that there's a transition? What happens if there is a moment when where the lines are crossed, where we no longer understand what is real and what is not real? Very, very important, you know. This is what something people don't believe is real. Okay? What do you say? Okay, you say this is probably, you know, on the top of sort of the, you know, list of horrific things that have happened, right? I mean, all the people that died, everything that gone on in terms of what motivated this event and the catastrophe it caused in New York. I mean, no one's ever going to forget this, right? What's fascinating, though, if just for a moment remove the equation of the emotion and the humanity, it's basically a David and Goliath situation. With the smallest amount of effort, with the smallest amount of tools, they were able to do what art should do, is to create a symbolic representation of an idea. This one event threw the world into absolute chaos. One event in one country, and the entire world started hunting down terrorism. All of a sudden, terrorism was our number one evil in the world. That's extraordinary, absolutely extraordinary. One event. And on the other side of the military side of it, this will probably go down in history as the most perfect military activity ever to take place. It was absolutely brilliant and it was absolutely flawless. So one has to, while one is in great pain over the loss of life, which there's no denying, and was it horrible to do? Absolutely. But we need to look at all sides of things. We don't look at only the sides of things that make us feel good. We need to understand everything about something. So you have to then imagine what it took to pull this off. I mean, this is at the level of Alexander the Great. This is at the level of Hannibal. I mean, I can go on and on and on of great military leaders. Napoleon, I mean, who had, they said Napoleon could pre-visualize the entire battle in his head before the battle took place. Hence why he was able to so brilliantly move his troops on the field, right? So anyway, these are surreal images that I find kind of, no matter when I see them, because for once I'll give in and tell you this is not Photoshop, right? This is real, right? This is not a trick of a contemporary time. They're extraordinary. They're mind-boggling images, if you ask me. There's no fiction or film, even though this has been suggested as a way to do this in film, the reality of it, that reality, is sort of undeniable, probably like the reality of Hiroshima and Nagasaki or the Armenian genocide or the camps in Germany during World War II. I mean, there's some things that are just undeniable. And you have to ask yourself, how can human beings do that to other human beings? It's quite simple, actually, because we're animals. We say that we're sophisticated, that we're in control with our intellect, but it's not true. Because you stop one little thing. I'd say, for example, I turn off all the electricity in California. In one day, you'd have anarchy. Absolute anarchy. Nothing would work. Nothing. You couldn't get your money out of the ATM. You couldn't go anywhere, do anything. Nothing. Everything would stop. Stop. Dead cold. You'd have absolute instantaneous. And then you would watch the civilized human beings go from being civilized so-called human beings into the most vicious animals you've ever seen to take something from someone else that they needed or wanted or for their survival over someone else's survival, right? Let me bring you to this. I'm going to do this kind of quickly, but I thought you should know where we spend our money in this country. As of 2011, there are more than 48,000 companies who have contracts with the United States Department of Defense, better known as the DOD. Of course, not all 48,000 companies are directly related to the war, but many of them have a vested interest in keeping America in a constant state of war. Do not underestimate that statement. There are companies that have vested interest in keeping the United States constantly in a state of war, okay? Interest keeping America in a constant state of war. To prove this point, all you have to do is take a look at stock charts of five major companies who have contracts with the DOD. As of this moment, $12.9 trillion. I don't even know what $1 trillion is. $12.9 trillion has been spent on the Iraq and Afghan war, and that is in conflict, as that gentleman pointed out earlier. Not wars, actually, but so and we haven't even calculated what the Libyan conflict has cost us. Yeah. No, I'm perfectly aware. That's why I'm making this point. But no, I think because it's good that you just said what you said, because you should speak up, everybody, if someone has something to say. But the issue is that this is a reality. This is real, okay? And like you said, this government might shut down. This state might shut down. Okay? And you have to ask yourself, why? Why is the United States in a state of economic crisis? You said it a little more brutally than I would have said it, but yeah. Basically, killing is very, it makes a lot of money. You sell weapons to both sides in the war, then you make profit there, then you go in with your companies and you build them back up, that what you just destroyed, and build their infrastructure up so they can have another war, so they can sell them more weapons and blow it up. I mean, so watch this. What year was 2011 in? I mean, what year was 2011? What year was 9/11 in? Okay, take a look at this. This is of Halliburton. See where they were in 2001? And see where they went. Now I'm gonna do this quickly, watch. This is Northrum. 2001, they were at the bottom of the barrel. And look at that. Next, General Dynamics. They were doing okay, maybe, not so good. Per the end, they did a little business somewhere. But then, bam, all during the war, straight up. Lockheed, same thing. The stock wasn't worth nothing. In the course of the period over the war, that's it. Boeing, same thing. So you have to... It's profit. You all are disposable. If I'm here, if I get hit by a truck on the way home, then nobody will notice. It's irrelevant. Right? People are irrelevant. What's relevant is profit. So the question is, how long are you willing to live under those circumstances? That's all. I mean, as this woman, young woman pointed out, yeah, what happens if this country shuts down? What happens if there's no more paychecks? What happens if the state can't keep, is this a state-run school? I'll give you, there's a perfect example. What happens if this school is shut down? I disagree. Because in every event that has ever taken place in relation to major catastrophes anywhere else in the world, only during the Vietnam did the population actually get up and attempt to bring it to the attention of the world. There has not been another moment where anyone has cared 2 cents. Things have gone, come and gone. Things that you couldn't conceive of have come and gone, and they just, it's like, oh, whatever, you know? But I guarantee you, you watch every school. I think if it happened nationally, yes, something would happen. But what if they shut down the school? What are you all going to do? What is your chancellor going to do? Right? Because he, right now, is doing everything he can do to fight and negotiate with the governance in this state in order to keep these doors open so that you can be educated. And if you don't understand that, it's a fact. It's the same as my school. I work for the state also. I work for the UC system. They have twice cut our paychecks 10%. Twice. How am I supposed to live on less money than I've been living on all this time? I mean, you see the paradox and the contradiction and the outright outrage that should exist, and it doesn't happen. It just comes and goes. That's why I disagree, and I'll show you, I'll give you the perfect. This is just a picture I took. I'm not sure where I was, but I just, Exodus, why couldn't you take a picture of it, right? How about this? Oops, whoopsie, oops. How about this image? Okay, see the gentleman, sir, this should have brought the world to its knees. It was news for one day, that's it, one day. No big. They hardly talk about Japan anymore now because it's old news. You know, it's more important, you know, which star is doing whatever they're doing. Look at this. Look at this. You want outrage? People should have been tearing. Something should have happened in response to these images. And nothing happened. Right? Causality. Does everybody understand the notion of causality? Cause and effect. What do we do when we exist, coexist, and have behavioral patterns? When there's cause, there's an effect, but there's no repercussions. There's no one held accountable. There's no response. There's no ethical response. There's no moral response. There's no response of any kind that would do justice to what took place here. Of course, artists are the funniest, so... This was some people in New York, 10,000 volts in your pocket, guilty or innocent, and they sort of, you know, redid the guy on the box with the thing. I mean, it's not funny, but that's funny, okay? So, first time I showed, this is a blood painting. It was made with several thousand gallons of blood, and this is the remnants of it. And what it was is that it's a machine that I made that is part human, part animal, an all machine, right? There's another close-up. So basically, I'm fist-fucking the hair. And see that my elbow? That's actually my real elbow. But it sort of looks like his balls, you know? That's kind of strange how that came out, isn't it? Like, because it's just mold of my own hand, right? Its extremity is for a purpose, right? It has to do with the connection to Joseph Beuys. I have lived my life very similarly to his teachings, because I was taught by Beuys' protege, Klaus Rinke. And in him teaching me, he was the closest thing I could ever get to being taught by Beuys. So I'm very passionate about Beuys, but there are some questions that need to be asked. There's some very serious questions that need to be asked about it. Okay, so in other words, what I do is I merge life, teaching, and art into one activity. But there are other questions that need to be, and I have a friend here that wants to ask me them. So anyway, this machine, here it is in from a long view. The hair goes back and forth on a rail. It works on an X, Y, and Z axis that is a random program. So what it does is it shoots the blood against the wall like an abstract painting, and eventually will continue till it covers the entire wall. And so this machine just goes on and on and on and on and on. I don't know if any of you were in Brian's class, but I think, Brian, you took your class? Where's Brian?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, last semester. So this was just at MoCA, and this worked. I probably received more generous compliments for the work being effective. This was an exhibition of works from the collection of MoCA, acquisitions. And when Deitch became the new director of MoCA, he called me up and said, because I knew him from New York, he says, hey, you want to be in the show? I said, okay, you know, what is it? He says, well, you know, it's going to be an acquisition show. We're going to acquisition something. And he said, we want something good. I said, well, what does that mean? You want something good? I mean, you got lots of good stuff. Which one do you want? He says, no, you misunderstood me. He says, I want something with impact. So they took this, right? This is just an example of how it paints. It cannot paint past the geometry of its programming. This is some close-ups of just the mechanism. That's the blood. That's something else. This is the last photo of the last day. The wall is so opaque, there's blood that thick on the wall. Look at the density of that color. It's extraordinary. This, what happened simultaneously, it was a list of every plague that has taken place in recorded time. And I made a list, handwriting them on the wall with the dates, but doing them by hand in order to not sterilize the actual event, but to put back into it a humanity of something that we don't quite understand, except for possibly currently with AIDS. I forget what just broke out in Haiti. Cholera, there we go, thank you. You know, I thought cholera was gone, right? Apparently not. So anyway, that was that. This sign, I was just in Guadalajara, and this sign is for scorpion removal. It's a scorpion, it's like, you know, bug people, like it spray your house with roaches and rats and things. This is for scorpions in your house. I mean, check that out. That was so good. You want a scorpion exterminator. I mean, you can't not help think of Burroughs, Joseph Burroughs, Jesus Christ, William Burroughs. This is I'm gonna go fast now. This is probably the project that I'm most proud of in my life. It was myself and two other artists. This was around 1996, after we had lost the culture wars, and there was absolutely no hope anywhere except for people that were the 1/8 of a percent making millions of dollars at the beginning of making money in the art world. Everything else was a disaster. Two friends of mine, we took 325 square feet and made it absolutely perfect based on all of my experience working in galleries and museums all over the world. In other words, I solved every single technical architectural problem beforehand so that any artist could walk into this gallery and it was perfectly made for them. Made by an artist for an artist. Not an architect making a museum, which they don't do too well, okay? But an artist making this space. The space was called Deep River. It lasted for 5 years. We individually funded this gallery ourselves. The artists paid absolutely nothing. We paid for everything. We were completely autonomous. We were free from anything being restricted in any way, shape, or form of what could be done in the form of aesthetic representation, aesthetic expression. I can't tell you. I mean, I could probably go on forever. There's a love of work that was very different because it was a reversal of circumstances. This is a picture that I don't actually know where it came from. I'm sorry that everything has a story, but you know, I dream every night and I dream extremely intensively. And what I do is I have a pad by my bed and I take, even if I wake up in the middle of the night, the pad is there so I can take notes of what I'm thinking or dreaming so that I'll remember them the next day. So one day I went into this dream and I woke up like broke out into this sweat, right? And I put my pad writing down all these notes. And this image was the image that I was dreaming. When I woke up in the morning, everything on my pad was illegible. It wasn't illegible because of my writing, which is illegible, but it was illegible because it was written in a language I didn't understand. It was extraordinary. I actually did not understand the language. I didn't even recognize it. But it was clearly a language. So then I had only dreamt this image. And then this image appeared. So I don't know. For me, it's probably as simple as it is, it's probably one of the most sublimely impactful, beautiful moments that I've ever dreamed. Because inside of the dream, it was pure ecstasy. It was pure, untainted by the outside world, right? Just so thin, so light, so fragile, like perfume in the air, right? Flowing along, and it disappears, right? That's what this image did for me. But anyway, I don't know how that happened. People tell me there's little people that run around your house and do that stuff, but I don't know. I'm missing a shoe. I lost my keys. I had two shoes one time. Took two shoes off. Went to bed. Two shoes were there. I guarantee you. I woke up in the morning. There was only one shoe. Okay. I tore my whole house apart to find the other shoe. The shoe could not have gone anywhere. There is no shoe in my house. Okay. Now you tell me who does that. Who took my shoe? Somebody took the shoe. What's that? The scorpions, maybe. It could be the leprechaun I have chained in the basement, but he's chained down, so, you know. But this is a piece I did this has to do with the West Bank and architecture. I'm gonna just kind of move here because I know we're running out of time. This is a night view. This is in New York at the Graduate Center in New York. These are 30 feet high sculptures made out of vacuum form. And they make the shape of, they coincide not only with geometric shapes, but they also coincide with the shapes of things that make patterns, like something that would make a pattern in industry, and also reminiscent of the tracks on tanks, right? So they serve several purposes. Would you really go hunting with this guy? Come on. So the day of the opening of the show in New York, the piece I just showed you, this photo was on the cover of the New York Times, and it was absolutely perfect. So I tore it out of the New York Times, and I stuck it on the wall. Settlers clash with Israeli forces in Hebron. So isn't it fascinating, again, how thin the line is, if there is a line anymore, between what we call everyday real life and real experiences and that which we make, which is art. Maybe they're not different. Maybe they're not separate. But it's the process of getting there that's probably difficult. This is the piece called Divine Violence that I had just did at the 2008 Whitney Biennial. I've made 300 gold-painted panels with a very specific kind of lacquer paint. It is very transparent. Handwritten on them are the names of every group in the world that I could find on the internet, and I'm still researching, I'm up to 5,000 groups now, who use violence as a means to control other people to believe things like they do. In other words, you use violence to suppress someone to then convince, to convert them, right? So every one of these groups, but some of the names you gotta go. Like Free Land, that one's good, okay? How about this? Anyone that reads Hart or Negre, The Multitude? I mean, there's a book named that, okay? This is good. Nuclei for Promoting Total Catastrophe, okay? This one, Martyrs from Morocco, Rejections of Sins and Exodus. Actually, that's why I threw the other Exodus in. I thought maybe a little play on there. Jewish Defense League. This might offend some people, but that's exactly, when the opening of the exhibition happening, what happened was people would go, oh yeah, look, this is a horrible group of people. Horrible. These are terrorists. And they would say, what's this group of people doing here? Because this group of people is good. They are helping people. If you believe that, you gotta go, you should go to school again. Okay? Everybody is indicted. Everyone is complicit. Nobody convinces other people that what their ideology or their belief system is without force. It's never happened. Except for the current social networking state that we're in. This one, Jana Weed, a man with a gun on a horse. That's great. Okay, how about this? This is Japan, right? Sane Thinker School. I want to find them so bad. Sane Thinker Schools from Japan. It's great. This one, the Afrikaner Resistance Movement. That's in South Africa. Oh, this one's good. Revenge of the Hebrew Babies. Okay. The All Nepal National Independence Revolutionary Student Union. The Rat Pack. That's from a different time, but it's pretty funny if you know the reference. It's, you know, it's Vegas, it's Sammy Davis Jr., it's Frank Sinatra, it's, yeah, forget it. Oh, this one's, the Tantan Makuntos is the Boogeymen National Security Volunteers. The names are extraordinary, Army of God. What country, just really quickly, what country do you think this is from? Absolutely correct. This is good, Fires of Hell. This is my favorite, World Punishment Organization. See, don't just punish one person, punish everybody. I mean, just like across the board. Why be selective, right? Okay? Here's a series of pictures. I used to work in at-risk facilities across the United States. I did this for quite a number of years. I would trade teaching art for access to the students. These students normally wear jail clothes and have some form of chains on them, anklets, the buzzers, something, because they have committed a crime that is deemed so atrocious before they're 18, they need to be held in these particular centers. And how old do you think this girl is? Huh? No, she's 15. No, but this one, how old is she? 13. Right, 13. Now, what could these girls have possibly have done? What could they have possibly have done that got them into that situation? You know, everyone's innocent, and I was told, don't ask. You don't ask what somebody does. So I get it, okay, I don't ask. But I traded it to take these portraits of them, and I have portraits of these kids from all over the country, and for me, they are... these children are extraordinary to me. They're absolutely beautiful. I mean, what did she do? What are we capable of? That's really the question. Because of the age, the gender. I have them of men also, but I, I can, and the point gets made clearer here. How about this girl? Look at her. What did she do? Decapitate somebody? I mean, seriously, I mean, what could have happened? Here's a small piece. It's a little performance photograph I did. It's a, I don't know, I lost my glasses too recently. So anyway, Oedipus confronted the Sphinx with logic. So she jumped off the rock to her death. Don't blame the Sphinx. Some just have this nature. And that's a finger puppet of Freud. So holding up his protest sign. This is, I'm just going to go, this is, I have 1,000 things to say. This is not call you blind, don't understand. I made a piece out of it. I got one frame of film offline on the internet of the surveillance camera in the cafeteria, and I kept it at the proper proportion in order for it to be absolutely technically accurate. But so I made this as a giveaway, and I'd never seen an image. I had a stack of 2,000 of these for an exhibition. By the end of the evening, they were gone. Now that always struck me as strange. Why would you put this image up in your home? It's a rhetorical question. Just think about it. This is my favorite sport that was invented in Los Angeles. I'm not talking about the crime. You want to be famous for a few minutes? You fill up your car with gas, do a few little things on the freeway, and the helicopters and the police will follow you for a very long time. You go to jail for a year and you're famous. That's performance art, okay? This is, I have a series of photographs that I'm doing, that I'm working with, something like WikiLeaks. I have found an individual who is willing to, let me borrow particular images that are done in black operations by the United States. And the only agreement was that I remove any recognition of anything that could identify the place, the time period. So there's nothing can be assigned to it. So what I did here is I removed all the bodies out of the scene. It's a real picture. So is that a real picture? Okay. What's the difference? Okay. This one is on the board. We did a show with Sam Duran and Andrew Bowers and a number of us. This is painted this on the side of the border wall on Tijuana. It says, the 19th century dislike of realism is the rage of Caliban seeing his own face in the mirror. And so I'm just going to try. Does anybody know where it's from? Oh, my God. I love you. I was just at Carnegie Mellon, 500 people in the audience, not one person knew it was Shakespeare. Not one person at Carnegie Mellon University identified this language as coming from Shakespeare and coming from specifically that play. I don't understand. What are they doing? What does this represent? See, is this a representation of faith? Is this a representation of fanaticism? Is this an image of devotion to God? Really, it's a matter of perspective. This is a devotion to God, is what it is. Okay? It's the same God that we've all, again, ever since there's been one God, we've been killing in his name. This is war everywhere in the world. There's a piece that was in that same show. We wanted to be radical, brave pioneers. We considered ourselves to be a vanguard. We overestimated ourselves ridiculously, indulging in the illusion that a revolution was thinkable in the Federal Republic. In this light, we were self-timers who acted cut off from reality in a void. We live in a sort of armed existentialism. More, this was, I was having some soup in Vienna. Just some of this. This was Prague during the war, blah. I just can't give one. This is a friend of mine's studio in the 1980s in Belfast. He had to put, he has a steel plate behind his door, and he puts bricks in the window because there were so many bombs and so many people being killed. But But yet there was still a ton of artists making stuff there. It was an absolute, I went almost 15 times in the 80s. And I did several projects, which I don't have time to explain, but I did several projects with people there that were very, very successful. This was then, right? And this is now. Okay, so the publisher of The New Yorker was on NPR, and he says, it was the best explanation I ever heard of this cover. It was fabulous. He said, you know, this is a parody. Of course it's a parody. He says, everybody knows this is a parody. There's no way you could misinterpret this. He says, you know, The New Yorker is not just for the people that live on the Upper East Side. The people is for America. It's for middle America. And I almost fell to the ground laughing. You've got to be kidding me. You've got to be kidding me. This is made for people on the Upper East Side, I guarantee you, okay? And whether it's parody or not, you have to ask yourself if it's proper. And where was Superman when you needed him? And why do people get upset when Janet Jackson shows her breasts, like we've not seen a breast before at the Super Bowl, or when two singers are kissing on stage? Like, really? That's what you get upset about? Because get over it. Because it's like really the most minor thing that you should be concerned about in the world. And they're actually quite famous, so. Or this is good. This is when you think different, and this is when Cesar Chavez used to have they set up Wi-Fi in the fields, and he had a small portable iPad that he was using in order to coordinate the shipments and the picking and the deliveries and coordinating the supply trucks taken out of the fruits, vegetables, and food that were picked by all the illegals that they say don't exist here. Or that they say exist here, but don't want to exist here. Something like that. Do you think that's a UFO? I wonder if that's a UFO. I don't know. So then you have America, you have Israel, and then you have this. This is also another tool of the 21st century. This is a predator drone. These are the most lethal, accurate, killing devices ever made. They kill everybody. They just kill. And you know what they do? It's a couple guys kicking it in Nevada, in a building. They play it like a video game. Then they go home and eat dinner with their kids. You know, we had a busy day today. We only sent out 50 drones. I mean, that was, you know, it's normally not that heavy of work, you know, but today we had a lot to do. Like, I mean, what's dinner talk for the guy that sends predator drones to destroy people? What's pillow talk, you know? Was it good, baby? I mean, give me a break, you know? These are people in trouble while other people are making, this is the state-of-the-art stealth battleship. It is absolutely invisible, more invisible to any technology that exists than the original stealth bomber, which was kind of not really a stealth bomber. But this is a ghost. It cannot be tracked currently by any technology that exists. It cannot be tracked. That's an extraordinary thing. So why do people build something like that? Then I wonder why people build walls. Why do people build walls? There's not been one instance in history where a wall being built has been successful. Ever. So why do you do it? And then there's another person here thinking about how you're actually going to reproduce organs for human beings. This is positive. It might sort of be weird, but it's, you know, growing ears on the back of a mouse, right? It's in genes, and it's extraordinary, right, that you can do that. Or this. This is a device that has theoretically been proven will work, but no one will build. And what this is, this device sets up a set of type of solar panels that is focused on the sun and can extract the energy from the sun that would power the entire Earth for infinity. We would never again have to use fossil fuel, anything that was harmful to us or the environment. And why aren't they building it? That's right. Good. This is a project I did in Puerto Rico. I made a edition of these prints. They're 100-year-old hand-carved woodblock prints that I make, these type of text works that are letter pressed onto this type of wax board. And this this neighborhood is called La Perla, and it's considered to be the most dangerous favela in the Caribbean, if not large. I mean, no one goes there unless you want to get killed. And whenever people say that, it's like, that's when they talk about the ghetto. Like, don't go to the ghetto, you know, there's black people there, there's Mexicans there. I mean, you know, they're dangerous, right? It's like, are you stupid or what? I mean, it's just another neighborhood with another group of people. That's all this was, a neighborhood. I cruised down there, there's no problem at all, you know? So I asked the neighbors, could I put up these prints all over to make these photographs? So that painting was there, and here's another one. Closed with the perfume of the absent, lying random, and then this ship in the back just was cruising by. It says Horizon Lines. That was sort of like perfect, you know. Avant-garde mixed with blood. Beneath the asphalt, the beach. This is the neighborhood I was in. It's not only an extraordinary neighborhood, but with the addition of this text, it creates a kind of surreal poetry, you might say. It's an intervention into the existence of everyday life for there. A black crow sits in a pink magnolia tree, cawing as Oregon accumulates and discharges in a split second over the city. I may be your lover, but I spit on your millennium. That was one of my good moments. I was happy then. I did a project about the Unabomber. It's the first time in history that they moved the actual cabin as forensic evidence of his insanity. The only problem with this is Thoreau was a genius, first of all. He killed people, that was his weak spot, but you know, but he was considered in the 1/4 top percent of mathematics at Harvard. He was an absolute genius. They thought he would take up actually in places where other major scientists had left off. This cabin is an exact copy of Thoreau's cabin at Wallen's Pond. So if the cabin is proof of insanity, then Thoreau's cabin is proof of something too. But what is it? Would we consider him insane? Okay, so this is them moving it. This is the actual sculpture that didn't fit in the gallery. And this, I'm at the end right here, so I wanna show you something that's, I'm gonna show you a set of images. You wanna know the fundamental obstacle that we have, I think it's probably global, but we have it more in particular in this country, I think. I shouldn't say that, that's probably not fair, but given the history of this country, I'm gonna extend myself here. To say that is outrageous. It's not only outrageous, it is a complete misunderstanding of history in every way, shape, and form, okay? But look who's doing this. That's what the Tea Party is using. Makes you wonder, doesn't it? Well, you know, I know that's not true, but it certainly appears like it from these images, doesn't it? But it seems that people forget this. See, I disagree with, I have an artist friend who was actually a student of mine. He did a series of work where he moved the images of the people that were hung. I philosophically disagree because I don't think the images are stronger with the absence. The conceptual theoretical basis by which he removal of the figure in this case does not broaden my understanding of these people who were willing to do this. I believe that the image in its origin is an image that should be burned into your memory. This image should never be forgotten, and it should never have what was impossible to be done, but is done. This cannot be forgotten. But so that's a little quibble I have with a friend of ours recently. How about this? That's the Tea Party for you. And then this. Or how about this? How about this? Check that out. Check that out. All you can say is like, whoa. Like, whoa. What's that? Or how, and do you remember this period? A lot of you won't, but those of us are a little, have a couple more years on you, will remember this. It's the exact same thing, okay? And then we go to this. Look at this. Look at this threat. Look at this threat, okay? And this is a gun store on the border, on the Mexican border in Texas. And the predominant sales is to drug lords in Mexico and to extremist groups in the United States. See, extremist groups, fanatical religious extremist groups, do not only exist in other countries. There are plenty of them here, more than enough to go around, right? And then this was one of the other posters, and then I will leave you with this image. This is Puerto Rico, and you never will see a more beautiful ocean in your life. I mean, and this sentiment here probably is, well, you know, I'll just let it speak for itself. In that case, thank you very much.